We start a new short series today, Songs for Life. And by songs, if I were to ask you to reach in the pew in front of you and take out a songbook, I know exactly what you would do. You would grab the hymnal and pull it out, and I'd say, wrong book. And you say, what are you talking about? There's no other songbook in there. Oh, yes, there is. It's called the Book of Psalms. The Book of Psalms. And the Book of Psalms is also called the Psalter. If you were to take that and open it just about in the middle of your Bible, you'd find the songbook. Now, this was the songbook for Israel. God is really into singing. He wants us to sing. There's a verse that says, He's put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto God. Many shall see it and fear and trust in the Lord. There's something about singing, okay? And there's something about singing. Singing is poetry. Did you ever notice that? It's poetry. It's got meter, syncopation. It's got rhyme. But if you were to read the book of the Psalms, you'd say, I don't see any of that. Where's the rhyme? Where's the syncopation? There's none of that. It's because in the Hebrew mind, poetry was not in rhyme and meter and all of that. It was on thoughts, a good thought, with another parallel good thought. Wow, that's poetry. So when we read those, they don't sing so well. And you can kind of figure out why there was not a big anarchy in the church when they abandoned the Psalms and went to hymns. You know, there's a thing they goes on, they call it worship wars. And because when you add a new song, I don't know that song. Why aren't we singing the old songs? Can you imagine the older Hebrew people saying to the younger ones who were no longer speaking Hebrew? Why are we singing all those new hymns when we got the inspired Psalms of God? And they're saying, well, we just don't get it. You see what I'm saying? Then comes along, you know, choruses. We went through a stage where there are a lot of choruses. And people were saying, well, what's wrong with the old hymns? We got all these new choruses. Then came along the praise music. Said, why are we praising all the choruses with the praise music? You see what's going on? Everything keeps changing. But the messages of the songs, some of the modern songs are really, really powerful. You know, it's just we don't know them yet. And once we know them, you know, another 15, 20 years from now, they're going to be saying, oh, I sure wish we could go back to those what we think are contemporary now and become traditional and old, okay? They're the classics. We're going to say, boy, I sure wish we could go back to that because we got this new one. I want to focus on some songs. I call these Songs for Life. We're going to look at a couple of them in this short series. And the first one is from Psalm 37, and it's How to Live Worry-Free. You see, when you're prone to worry, and we all have agreed already today that we're prone to worry, that he gives us in this psalm at the very beginning, I think, 10 actions to take when you are prone to worry. And I don't know if it's a big worry, a little worry. You're worrying about your kids, you're worrying about your parents, you're worrying about your job, you're worrying about the economy, you're worrying about the nation, whether we'll go to war or not. Well, I don't know what has you worried. If you're worrying about a test exam tomorrow, what your boss is going to say about your performance last week, I don't know. But I do know this. Most of your worry, about 90% of it, never ever happens. It's all about the hypothetical. It just might happen. If you were to actually write them down and then keep track of what you're worried about, see if it ever happens, you'll find it didn't really happen anyway, and you surely wasted all your time and energy. But even though we all know that, we still all do that. So here's some action. I just first want to show you what I'm talking about. I got this little red flag there. It says, do not fret. I'm fretting, you know, I'm worrying. I got this anxiety because of evil men. Now, this is something that's actually threatening David's life. You know, he's being threatened. And so this is pretty big. David is saying, and it's an imperative. Do not worry. All right? Sometimes David talks to himself. He'll say something like, why are you cast down, O my soul? Well, the you there is really, he's just talking, it's like he's in front of the mirror, and he's saying, why are you doing this? And I don't know, maybe here he's in the mirror, and he's saying, don't fret. You see, sometimes you got to talk to yourself. You just got to tell yourself, don't worry. He goes on, and he couples that, and don't be envious. So the things that he's going to share here in the Psalms work for both being worried and for being envious. You know what this envy thing is? It's related to worry. I envy when I'm worried that somebody else is going to have it better than me, and I'm worried that they're going to do better than me, and I want what they have. You see, I get envious because I'm worried that they'll have something better than me. So they're kind of tied together. He says, listen, don't worry because of evil men, and don't be envious of those who do wrong. Isn't it like that? It seems like the bad person, nothing goes wrong for them, and everything goes wrong for me. A few weeks from now, we're going to talk about that. There's a whole psalm that talks about, man, my feet are slipping. My life is going down the tubes. But the guy who doesn't even fear you seems like he's just rising. We're going to deal with that. And he says here, don't worry about that. Here he gives a reason for, like the grass, they will soon wither. Like the green plants, they will soon die away. It's kind of like, you know what? Their day's coming. Their day's coming. He says, don't worry, but instead, here's what you do. Stop worrying. Start trusting. Trust in the Lord. I call that commit. Now, I don't need to give you a token to remind you of this. You carry the tokens in your pockets, in your purse. You've got money. All you got to do, you get worried, you pull that money out, and you just read on there, in God we trust. In God we trust. You commit your, the text says, trust in the Lord. Now, the word trust here is kind of similar to the word believe. When you believe something, in fact, when you believe, you commit yourself to it in real biblical faith. In the Gospel of John, one time the word belief, in the New Testament Greek word belief, is translated in the King James Version of the Bible to commit. It said Jesus did not believe himself to them, to the people. He did not commit himself to them. He did not put himself into their care. And that's the whole idea of real faith. Real faith, you have trust. And he's saying you commit it to God. I don't know what's bugging you, bothering you, burdening you, got you down, you're worried, frustrating you, and you're fretting about it. First thing he says is, you commit it to God. You know what we usually do? We usually go to God as last resort. Well, why don't I go, oh, duh, I should have gone to God first. I could have saved 2 days of worrying. I could have just gone to the Lord, committed it to him. First thing, action to take, commit it to the Lord. Second thing is just do the right thing. Sometimes when we're worried, we do stupid things. We act out on that worry, and we go talking to people about what might happen, and it's never going to happen, and then they later say, you were so foolish, so silly. It's never going to materialize. So you do the right thing. That's the Boy Scout model, do the right thing, right? We call it Scout's Honor. In the book of Acts, it says, Jesus went about doing good. Jesus always did the right thing. Remember a while back, everybody's wearing those WWJD bracelets, what would Jesus do? To remind you that what you want to do is the right thing. And so if you want to take action to stop the worry, you do the right thing. So you ask yourself, what would Jesus do? And then you do what Jesus would do. And if you do the right thing, you will eventually dispel all your worry. It will. It'll go away. Watch as we go along in the text. Third thing, dwell in the land. Now, the land here is not just any land. The land here, to David, is Canaan, the promised land. You see, this is the land that Genesis 1:1, God created. Genesis 1:1 and 2, it says God created the heavens and the land. It's in Genesis chapter 12 that God promised to Abraham, this is the land I promised you. And that's why it's called the promised land. It's the promised land to Abraham. This is the land that Joshua went in and conquered. For those of you reading through your Bible, you know Joshua went into the land. He conquered the land in the first 12 chapters of Joshua. The last 12 chapters of Joshua, he passes and parcels it out to all the Jews. And so this is the land. Now for the Jewish person, this is the place where God wants them. In the land, not outside the land. So the land becomes almost synonymous with being in God's will. So what the text is really saying here, he's saying, live in the land, live in the will of God, live where God wants you. Now, there's a little book of the Bible called the Book of Ruth. And the Book of Ruth is about a guy by the name of Elimelech. Elimelech's name means, my God is king. Isn't that a great name? My God is king. It's a great name. Too bad you didn't act like that. We'll find that out in a moment, okay? Elimelech is married to a gal by the name of Naomi. And Naomi's name means my pleasantness. Well, the pleasantness in the sense that when Eve looked at the fruit, it was pleasant to the eyes. It's like beautiful, all right? So here, the guy whose name is my God is king is married to a gal who's called beautiful. Great story, huh? I mean, so far. They have two sons, and here's where the little rub comes in. It's really weird. One calls the one son is called Mahlon, the other son is called Chilion. Mahlon means sickly, and Chilion means pining away. I don't know. Maybe she was really sick with her pregnancy, because that, you know, they often name the kid about something going on in life, and said, she's really sick with that pregnancy, and she calls him sickly. Maybe the second one, she's about to die from the pregnancy, and she calls him pining away. Anyways, these names become prophetic. Well, there's a famine in the land. You know, it's not always easy being a Christian. You ever notice that? My neighbor doesn't have worries. I got worries. What's going on here? Everything seems to be going wrong for me, and everything's fine for him, and I have problems, and they don't seem to have any problems. You see, being a Christian doesn't mean you can take all your problems away. Well, there's a famine in the land. It's not always easy being in the will of God. All right? And so because there's a famine in the land, they hear from another land while they're living in a place called Bethlehem. Now, Bethlehem is in Judah, and they're Ephrathites in this land. Now, the word Bethlehem means house of bread. Isn't that interesting? And Ephrathite means double the fruit. They're living in the will of God, the land, and the house of bread, the cupboard should be full, all right? And it should have double blessing because it's double fruit. In Judah, which means praise God. Isn't this great? So my God is king, is living with my beautiful, and they're in the house of bread, and they should have double plenty of everything. They're praising God, but there's a famine in the land. Things aren't going according to plans. But they hear about another place called Moab. There's no famine in Moab. And Moab, in fact, times are good over there. I'm looking at my neighbor. Things are pretty good over there. What good is it serving God here in the land when everything's much better over there? Now, the word Moab means from father. Moab was named from father, and his father was Lot. Those of you reading through your Bible know that Lot left the promised land and chose that region for Sodom and Gomorrah. Have you ever heard those names before? It's the world, it's wickedness, it's everything that's contrary to the will of God. And so they leave the will of God to go a place there where they're out of the will of God. And it says at first they're going to go there for a short while. Then a little later in the first chapter, it says then they live there. They settle down there. The boys, about 10 years later, they're grown up. Elimelech dies out of the land. But she's got two sons, find two attractive young Moabite women. One's name is Orpah. The one marries Orpah. Orpah's name means back of the neck. Very symbolic of what she does later. The other one's name is Ruth. Her name means friendship. So these two guys, there's two weddings they can celebrate, even though there's been a death. My God, his king died because he was out of the will of God. And he's in this land, he dies. But it says after these two were married, it says they both die. They both die. So now you got a widow woman and two widow daughter-in-laws. And she all of a sudden hears, whoa, after they went to Moab and they dwelt there in the land, they hear back in the will of God. God is blessing. Everybody that stayed there, they're being blessed. God is just blessing in the land. The pantries are full. The fruit is double. Everything's going wonderful. And so what we got going on here is, Naomi says, my pleasantness, beauty says, I think I'm going to go back to my home country. I'm going to go back to Bethlehem. I'm going to go back to the house of bread. I'm going to go back to the will of God. And her daughter said, we'll go with you. And she says, oh no, my daughters, don't go with me. Stay here with your parents, because listen, even if I were to get married again and had two sons, would you wait till they were full grown to marry them? No, stay with your moms. And Orpah, whose name is, who started out with her on the way back, her name is back of the neck, turn back. She goes back. Ruth, who is a friend, says, no, no, where you go, I will go. Where you live, I will live. Where you die, I will die. Your God will be my God. And may it ever be so bad to me if anything but death separates the two of us. And she goes back to the land. Now, when she comes back to the will of God, there's this blessing going on. It's harvest season. And here comes my pleasantness. Here comes my beauty comes back. And everybody says, whoa, isn't this Naomi? Isn't this the beautiful one? And she says, don't call me beautiful. Call me Mara. Mara means bitter. Bitter. She says, the Lord dealt with me bitter. Oh, wait a minute. Listen to what she says. I went out full and I came back empty. I said, whoa, hold on here. Didn't you leave because there was a famine and life wasn't full? You left, and that's where it got empty, outside the will of God, not in the will of God. Now you're returning. Can you imagine poor Ruth standing there? I went out full, and I come back empty. And she's saying, what am I, chopped liver? Oh, God is going to bless. It's barley season. He's going to bless now that they're in the will of God. Ruth is the biggest blessing in her life. And although everything was meant for evil, God's going to turn it for good. And he works everything together for good to those who are called according to his purpose, who are in his will. You see what's going on here? He says, dwell in the will of God. Next thing he says is find safe pasture. Find a safe place. Sometimes you just got to remove from everything and just find a safe place where you can focus on trusting the Lord, doing good, dwelling in God's word in a safe environment. Next, he says, delight yourself in the Lord. I love this verse. I used to have a picture with this instead of a happy balloon, a guy trying to tickle himself. Okay, that's the whole idea. You do this to yourself. Make yourself happy in the Lord. You know what happens when we get worried? We got anxious thought, and all we do is play this broken record over in our minds. Woe is me. That's so horrible for me. What if this happens? What if this other thing happens? And I just keep playing this whole thing over. I'm like Eeyore. I got this rain cloud over my head, and that's all I focus on. And God says, stop. Stop. Delight. Make yourself happy in me. Get your mind off yourself. And focus on me. Make yourself happy. Now, years ago, there was this great Christian song. You probably don't recognize it as a Christian song, but this song, don't worry, be happy. It's not a contemporary praise song because it's now a classic, but this song, don't worry, be happy, I think grabs the whole idea here. Stop worrying, it said in the very first verse, but delight yourself in the Lord. I don't normally do this, but I want you to stand. We're going to sing this song. We're going to sing this song. This is one of those great Christian songs that you all know. All right? Don't worry. Be happy. Come on. You know this song, don't you? Yeah, I can tell. Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry.
Let's hear it.
Be happy.
All right. In every life we have some trouble.
But when you worry, you make it double. Don't worry. Be happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry.
Don't worry.
Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
All right, you may be seated. You did really good on that. You didn't even know that was a Christian song, did you? That song is saying exactly what this verse is talking about. He says, if you will not worry, be happy, he will give you the desires of your heart. Is this amazing? This is the first promise in the text. Everything up to this has been telling you what to do, and God says, now this is what I will do. There's another a proverb. It goes, Proverbs 23:7 says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So if you're just thinking, worry, 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 guess what you are? You are a worry wart, right? But if you will delight yourself in the Lord and delight yourself in the Lord, no matter what your circumstance, you know what you're going to be? You're going to be a blessing. God is going to give you the desire of your heart. You see, listen, if you're dwelling in the land in his will like he wants you to, you're doing the right thing, and you're trusting God, he is going to give you the desire of your heart, because what you're going to want is what God wants. It's a very simple formula here. Let's go to the next one. He says, commit your way to the Lord. The word here for commit is literally the word gal, which means to roll. It means to roll. I suggested this in my prayer this morning when I said, sometimes our burdens are too big. Because Peter says, cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. All right? You throw them on him, but what if they're too big and you can't pick it up? You roll it on him. You roll it on him. Well, yesterday we went to the ball game, Tiger ball game. And it was freezing cold. Ask Connie. Connie and I, we were both layered. I had 4 layers on, and I froze. I froze. But I have a little buddy here with me. Come on up, Chris. Come on up, Chris. He wondered why I picked him up for church today. I said, Chris is my man. This guy didn't worry about a thing. I picked him up in the morning, and he was wearing shorts. Right?
Yeah.
He was wearing shorts, this with a shirt underneath it, this the same jacket, and I said, Chris, like, man, it's cold out. It's only going to hit maybe 50 degrees today. You sure you don't want to get some pants on? He said, nah, I'm fine. I love it when a guy is tough. You're awesome. You're awesome. And you know what? During the game, he never once complained, did you? Until it was in the 9th inning and the Tigers tied it up and we went into extra innings. His legs were turning blue and purple, and that is definitely a Bethany moment. We give Bethany pins for people who do outstanding things. Congratulations. This guy didn't worry. He kept pushing all of his burdens aside. He didn't worry about it at all. He knows what it is not to worry. Just be happy and go with the flow. Go with the flow. Take your burden, cast it elsewhere. He did. After the game was over, I said, oh, Chris, I had a raincoat in my pocket. I forgot to give that to you. You could at least wrap yourself in the raincoat. He said, gee, thanks. I mean, not upset. Not upset at all. He just went with the flow. Went with the flow. Hey, you just go through, roll your burden away. Get rid of that thing. Listen, he goes on, he says, trust in the Lord. That's exactly what he started. He's saying, there's like 2 bookends here. Do all this stuff. Trust in the Lord. And watch what it says next. I love this part. It says, and he will do this. Second promise of what God will do. First of all, he'll give you the desire of your heart. Second promise is God will move into action. It's the same word that he used for creating on day one. God will make is what it says. God will act. Some of you feel like God's not active in my life. Well, maybe you need to do numbers 1 through 6 there, and then God will act. God will act. He'll do something. In fact, this is what he says. He will make your righteousness, that's what you do right, it will shine. This is almost judicial. It's almost like you're in court. And he'll make what you're doing right shine before the judge. He goes on and he says, and your justice, your just cause, he will make it be like the noonday sun. Man, it'll just be a beam of light on it. And he says, listen, God will move into action on your behalf. On your behalf. He goes on and he says, number 7. He says, be still before the Lord. I call this just take a time out for God. When you're worrying, you need to just pull yourself away from everything. You just pull yourself away from everything. And sometimes that's why God isolates us when we're really worrisome situations. We find ourselves all isolated and alone. And so that's your alone time with God. You get in the Bible and you pray before it and say, God, I'm going to read until you speak to me, so speak, Lord. And you start reading God's word. I don't care where you jump in. If you jump in Genesis, you might have to read all the way, to the Psalms. You might have to read for a while. But God will speak to you through his word because the Bible is the word of God. Sometimes you read just a couple verses and God will just jump off the page at you and say something to you, still your heart. Sometimes you read a couple chapters. Sometimes you got to read through a book. But God, you take time out and you spend some time with God. You pray to God and you tell him what it is that's really got you burdened and down. And you just get it out. Give it to the Lord. And then you leave it there. The next one is you wait patiently for him. We are in such a hurry. So I'm saying, oh man, this is a great list. I'm going to go down through all 7 of those, and then, boy, tomorrow, my world will be perfect. You know what he's going to say? No, I want to see if you'll do that one more day in a row. Oh, let's see. Can you actually do that 3 days in a row? See, what he's saying is, wait patient. You got to endure the pressure you're under. And the idea here is I wait longingly. I'm waiting with expectation and longing for God to move into action, not me. I'm waiting for God to do what he said he's going to do. He's going to move into action. He's going to give me the desire of my heart. But if I think it's on my time schedule, God is saying, no, I'm still waiting to see if you're really committed to this. You see, that's that word trust. Am I really committed and trusting in him, or am I just playing games with God? Yeah. The next, before he gets to the next one, he says, do not fret. Second time, verse 1 he said it, now he's seconding this. When men succeed in their way, don't get your eyes on other people. That's why you got your time out. You're focusing on you and God. Don't get your eyes on other people when they're succeeding and they're carrying out their own wicked schemes. Don't do that, he says. Then he says, refrain from anger, because that's what's going to happen. You look at others and you're going to get angry. You're angry with God. God, why aren't you doing this on my time schedule? God, why is everything going well with him? And you get angry. You got to let go of your anger. That's what impressed me about Chris. Chris, it really wasn't phasing him at all. The guy was freezing, weren't you? At one point he said to me, I can't even feel my legs. Yeah. Never got angry, never got upset about it, went with the flow. Because he knew it sooner or later, we're going to get back in that car and he's going to sit right in front of that heater. And he's going to defrost his legs. Yeah. Don't get angry. Let go of getting even. Sometimes we're worried because of bad things people have done to us, and we really would like to just turn the tables and get even with them. You just let go of that, and you let God deal with that. You let God deal with that. Because you're worried about they're going to get away with it. Let God do it. Let God take care of it. Let God take care of it. Then he says, for the third time, do not fret. Don't worry. It only leads to evil. He goes on and says, for evil men will be cut off from, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. You're going to inherit what the will of God is. God has a will for your life. He's got a plan for your life. Ultimately, you're going to get that. He says, so why in the world would you waste your time worrying and fretting and being anxious over everybody else? He says, in a little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. They're going to be gone. They'll be out of your life. They'll be gone. But the meek will inherit the land. The land. And enjoy great peace. Isn't that what you really want? You don't worry, you want peace. You want peace. Three times the following is mentioned in the text. Three times. Don't fret, don't fret, don't fret. I call that stop worrying, stop worrying, stop worrying. Three other times in the text it mentions the land, the land, the land. And the land is the will of God. Don't fret. Just be in the will of God. And if it's His will that you're going to have a little difficulty and road bumps along the way, you just say, God, I'm just trusting you. I'm doing those 10 things because I want to be in your will so that there will be a reward. Because I know that when I'm in your will like that, that you, God, will move into action. You, God, will give me the desire of my heart. And you, God, will give me the peace and the tranquility that I need. Is this a powerful passage? Is this a great song? Is this something that we should really be singing? Just as a reminder, because I know some of you didn't take notes today, I made the notes for you. I have a little bookmark. I'm going to pass this out to everyone else so you go out the door. And it says, don't worry. It's got everything on it. You can put it on your refrigerator. You can put it in a book you're studying. Put it in your Bible. But it ends by saying, if you do these things, God will give you the desire of your heart. He'll move into action. He'll give you peace. He'll give you peace. I want you to test God. Put him to the test. Put him to the test. Don't worry. Be happy. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we don't want to be a people who are worry warts. We want to be a people who are in the will of God, experiencing the peace of God that transcends all understanding. That peace that will blow our minds and everyone around us when we have trusted in the Lord, committed our way unto you, rolled it all upon you, given it over to you. When we dwell in the land and Lord, we'll just see you move into action. It'll blow our minds. Help us today as we leave this place to focus on you and not on ourselves, that we might experience your peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.